Amen. Turn your Bibles to 2 Samuel chapter 4, is where we left off last time. Abner, remember, was mercilessly killed by Joab back in chapter 3. Joab, partly political, but mostly personal, took matters into his own hands, and he took Abner out. And that seems to be a theme throughout our study in 1 Samuel and 2 Samuel, that warning not to take things in our own hands. With Abner dead now, the tribes of Israel are vulnerable. They're vulnerable because the weak leadership of the puppet king Ishbosheth. So keep that in mind as God is using all these things and working all things together, just like he says in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. All these series of events where you're like, oh no, and how could this happen? And we watch them unfold, but keep this in mind because God uses it all to bring about a unified kingdom. So notice verse 1 of chapter 4, and the word of Samuel came to all, And when Saul's son heard that Abner had died in Hebron, he lost heart, and all Israel was troubled. Now Saul's son had two men who were captains of troops. The name of one is Baana, and the name of the other is Rechab, the sons of Rimmon, the Beharathite of the children of Benjamin. For Beharoth also was part of Benjamin, because the Beharathites fled to Gittim and have been sojourners there until this day. Verse 4. Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son who was lame in his feet. He was 5 years old when the news about Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel, and his nurse took him up and fled. And it happened, as they made haste to flee, that he fell and became lame, so his name was Mephibosheth. Keep him in mind as a later chapter, we'll spend some time looking at him. Verse 5. Then the sons of Rimmon, the Beharathite, Rechab and Baana, set out and came at about the heat of the day to the house of Ishbosheth, who was lying on his bed at noon. And they came there all the way into the house as though to get wheat, and they stabbed him in the stomach. Then Rechab and Baana, his brother, escaped. Now, for when they had came into the house, he was lying on his bed in his bedroom. Then they struck him and killed him, beheaded him, took his head, and were all night escaping through the plain. And they brought the head of Ishbosheth to David at Hebron and said to the king, "Here is the head of Ishbosheth, the son of Saul, your enemy, who sought your life. And the Lord has avenged my lord the king this day of Saul and his descendants." The chapter begins with the discouragement of Ishbosheth. He lost his right-hand man. Really, he lost the man that was giving him the right information and the kind of leadership that gave him a comfort in overseeing the country, overseeing the tribes of Israel. But as we know, so goes the leader, so goes the people. And in verse 5 now, you have one man's weakness and vulnerability, a time of sorrow and sadness, a time in Ishbosheth's life of having to assess everything, having to consider now leading the country on his own when he knows he really didn't belong there. Now, having lost his right-hand man, he becomes weaker and vulnerable. And it's unfortunate, and we've seen this time and again, both biblically and in regular life, that one man's vulnerability and weakness is often seen by another man as an opportunity to take advantage of him. And it's always sad. One of the ways to say that is when, you know, when times get tough, you find out who your real friends are. And you find out who your real enemies are. And here's a tough time. And the hearts of people are being revealed, and an opportunity was taken by these guys, Rechab and Baana. They come about the heat of the day, it says in verse 5, the time of the afternoon nap. And they sneak in while he's sleeping and cut his head off. And so what did Ishbosheth do? Like, what did he do to deserve this? He didn't do anything. No doubt weakened over the reality of the current situation and having to assess all the responsibilities. The murder of Abner was merciless, but this murder was heinous. And that really is the environment. Ishbosheth did nothing. All he suffered for just being Saul's son. So they come to David and they bring his head there, and they come with great confidence as if this act would have pleased David. Verse 9. David answered Rechab and Baana, his brother, the sons of Rimmon, the Berethite, and said to them, "As the Lord lives, who has redeemed my life from all adversity, when someone told me, saying, 'Look, Saul is dead,' thinking to have brought good news, I arrested him and had him executed in Ziklag. The one who thought I would give him a reward for his news. How much more when wicked men have killed a righteous person in his own house on his bed? Therefore, shall I not now require his blood at your hand and remove you from the earth?" So David commanded his young men, and they executed them, cut off their hands and feet, hang them by the pool in Hebron, but they took the head of Ishbosheth and buried it in the tomb of Abner in Hebron. So once again, David is faced with a situation where he's required to declare his innocence of this evil act. He wanted it to be clear, I have nothing to do with this. Because again, you've got a personal thing going on in David's life, but you also have a political thing going on at this time because the kingdoms are divided. You have Judah being overseen by David in Hebron, and you have the tribes of Israel overseen by Ishbosheth and with Abner. So there's also a political thing going on here, and he's declaring his innocence both as a man and as a leader. He gives them a story, and he reminds them the last time somebody tried to do this. It would be wise for them to have paid attention to that. Perhaps they never heard it. But verse 9 is very encouraging. David declares the faithfulness of God. He says, "As the Lord lives, who redeemed my life from all adversity." Now, that's a pretty big statement, because he's covering about 10 years of his life, the last 10 years of his life. The 10 years of his life that connected him with Saul. The 10 years of his life that connected him with the son of Saul, Ishbosheth. And when he looks back on the 10 years, he says, "God has delivered me from all adversity." God gets the glory. It would be hard in the midst of the 10 years, but now as he looks back, God is beginning to reveal to him his faithfulness in greater ways. "The Lord has redeemed my soul out of all adversity." In other words, David has learned an important lesson, and that was his commitment of his life to the Lord. He learned to commit his life to the Lord. He learned to commit the things of his life to the Lord. He learned in many ways by his mistakes and by his successes not to take things into his own hands. Why? Because when he took things into his own hands, he failed. When he allowed the Lord to act on his behalf, there was great success. But when he sums up 10 years, all the time that we studied through 1 Samuel, or at least the second half of 1 Samuel, he looks back and he goes, "You know, the Lord delivered me. All the adversity, God has delivered me. He's taken care of me. I don't need you guys to commit such a heinous sin on my behalf. I don't need you to take out Ishbosheth. I don't need you to do anything in the flesh on my behalf." You know, that I was thinking as I was jotting down my notes, you know, and I wrote it down. Oh, that we would learn that lesson. That we would learn it once and for all. I'm often trying to take things into my own hands. I often find myself jumping in where I could have let the Lord jump in. I find myself trying to fix things or put things together. At other times, I think I can help the Lord out a little. Do you guys think you can help the Lord out a little? Just a little bit, not much, just a little. I'm often guilty of moving out on my own. I'm often guilty of doing what I feel needs to be done, not being led of the Lord, rather than just committing it to the Lord and trusting him to act on my behalf. Just leaving it in the Lord's hands. Such a place of faith. A place of faith leaving things in the Lord's hands. He's teaching, and I'm learning, but not as fast as I would like. We grow through our successes, don't we? But we also grow through our failures and how we respond to our failures. And to some degree, David's learned his lesson. In another way, he's got a lot more to learn. The Lord has redeemed me out my... He says, as the Lord lives, who has redeemed my life from all adversity. The Lord delivered me. I don't need man. I've got the Lord working on my side. And what a lesson to learn. These guys came to David thinking that through their heinous crime, David would be happy and join in and reward them. They fully expected to be rewarded. They fully expected to be praised. They thought that David was going to exalt them. Maybe give them a place, make them generals in the army or see their great skill. I mean, what a sight that must have been. The last time we find David with a head was the enemy of God being destroyed, and his name is Goliath. He doesn't need his help to take down an innocent, who David calls a righteous man, where his only mistake, if you will, or his only issue is being Saul's son. And so David appeals to his example. It's always good to have a life above reproach, that when you are sharing with someone or talking to someone, that you can appeal to your own example, to your own previous actions, where you can look, like Paul would often say, where he would come and as he's writing to the churches, he'd say, you know how I came to you. He writes in Acts chapter 20 to the elders of Ephesus, you remember, I was among you. I didn't take anything from you. I just came to serve. He would write to another church, you know, we worked with our own hands to provide for our own needs. He would appeal to his own example. And in many cases, we can do that. We can look back in our lives and see many examples. And then, of course, there are times in our lives where our example is not to be appealed to. But it's a good place to be, don't you think, as a believer, where you can appeal not only to the examples of the scriptures, but you can appeal to your own relational, your own relationship and the example that you've given, to be above reproach. Our lives are as important or even more so than our words, our lives. Paul would often refer back to his noticeable actions. Jesus would too in John chapter 10, verse 37. We just looked at it not too long ago. He said, don't believe me unless I carry out my Father's work. But if I do his work, believe in what I have done, even if you don't believe me, then you'll realize that the Father's in me and I'm in the Father. Hey, if you don't want to believe what I say, then just believe what I do. Now, what a testimony that is. So don't, if you don't want to believe what I say, we spend so much time with our words trying to convince, we just say, hey, believe what I do. Watch my life. Even if you don't ask people to watch your life, people are watching your life. You'll have people in your life, you know, especially, there'll be those that don't have any relationship with the Lord, but they think they're the experts on what it means to have a relationship with the Lord, and they'll call out every mistake they ever see in you. And you'll have some mistake, you know, you'll make a mistake and you'll hear, oh, that's what a Christian does. And you're just like, oh man, all this time I've been sharing with them. And finally, you know, this people are watching our lives. They're listening to what we say. They're reading what you post on Facebook. People read that. They look at your pictures. And it's good to have an example that you can look, you can say, no, this is my life. It's not just what I say, this is my life. So before we move to chapter 4, or excuse me, move on to chapter 5, just again, mark and maybe read ahead in verse 4, Mephibosheth. Just mark his name, mark his life. He's this handicapped child the next time we meet him. He's the only living heir now to King Saul's throne. And we'll meet him again in future chapters. If you want to study ahead, please do. Chapter 5, verse 1. Then all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and spoke, saying, indeed, we are bone of your bone and your flesh. We are your bone and your flesh. Also in time past, when Saul was king over us, you were the one who led Israel out and brought them in. And the Lord said to you, you shall shepherd my people Israel and be ruler over Israel. So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron. And King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord. And they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 40 years in Hebron. He reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months. And in Jerusalem, he reigned 33 years over all Israel and Judah. So with Ish-bosheth dead, the 11 tribes of Israel had no king. Abner, you'll recall, was already putting something together and bringing all the tribes together, both Judah and the 11 of Israel. And he had already brought them together, but now that decision is to be ratified. And finally, David is now receiving the promise of God after 10, really many more years, because we have a few years before when he was first anointed as a young kid, a young lad that was called in after all his brothers were looked over and not chosen, but he was anointed. He was anointed many times, and now finally, you know, you get that place where finally the will of God is being accomplished. The leaders of Israel come to Hebron and remind David that he belongs to the whole nation, not just Judah. And the covenant was ratified in Hebron, and now David's king. Isn't it one of the hardest things to do in your Christian life is waiting on the Lord? And think of waiting on the Lord with all the kind of warfare and all the kind of nonsense that happens. And yet David reminds us that, hey, you want to mark verse 3, all the elders came and King David made a covenant with them, and they anointed David king over Israel. He is now the kingdom of God at this point is now a united kingdom under one king. Finally, it's come to pass. When David was younger, Samuel, remember, anointed him privately in 1 Samuel chapter 16. Then the elders of the tribe of Judah had anointed him when he became their king at 30 years of age in 2 Samuel chapter 2. But now the elders of the unified nation anoint David and proclaim him as their king. And when you see anointing in the scriptures, it speaks of the empowering of the Lord. It speaks of the authority of the Lord, the ability of the Lord, and the approval of the Lord. Anointing was a very serious thing. Today in the church, what we do is we lay hands on. We don't have the ability to give the anointing of God. God himself gives the anointing. And what we find in our leadership is we recognize the hand of God in someone's life and we lay hands on them. We believe in the doctrine of laying on of hands of the leadership to encourage someone in their calling, to encourage someone in the empowering that God has given them, to encourage someone in the authority that God has given them, to encourage someone in the ability and the approval that God has given to them. David was a seasoned warrior and a gifted leader who has obviously had the blessing of God upon his life. It was obvious. His entire life was used to prepare him for this day. His entire life up to this point was used of God to prepare him for this day. Do you know the same is true for you? Everything in your life is preparing you for what's up ahead. You could say that everything in your life prepared you for this night, this Bible study. It may not be a very significant Bible study for you. It may not be a very significant date on the calendar. It may be just seen as another day serving the Lord. But for some of you, someone listening in right now, today's a very significant day. God revealed himself in an amazing way. Something was fulfilled in your life. Something came to pass in your life. God gave some word to you. And you can say and think in your own mind that my whole life God used to bring me to this day. I mean, how encouraging is that? I think if we would have dropped into David's life in the middle, in the beginning of his time running in the wilderness, I believe it would be hard to convince him that God was going to use the wilderness to prepare him to being king. I mean, don't kings go to king school? Isn't that how they get trained? I mean, don't they just get trained through the order and, you know, getting ready and all the protocol and how to hold the knife and, you know, all of that? Isn't that how kings get trained? Well, some have the privilege of going through an easier school like that, but not David. David was trained a completely different way. He was trained in the wilderness, on the run, being chased by another king, having spears thrown at him, having his life at peril and all the men with him. Being surrounded with all those that were discouraged, all those that were in debt. Remember, they got so mad at David when Ziklag was invaded by the Amalekites that they turned on him and wanted to stone him. It was his lowest moment, right after a backslidden time. And yet we learn he encouraged himself in the Lord, and his entire life was used to prepare him for this day. After experiencing years of turmoil and discord, the nation at last has a king, unified in the purposes of God. And God does take time to prepare his leaders. It doesn't happen overnight. And much is to be pitied, as once said, the person who succeeds before he or she is ready for it. There's a lot of learning that takes place in God's way and God's timing. And I believe if we were to drop into David's life any time in the last 10 years and said, don't worry about it, David. It's coming. Don't worry about it. 8 more years. Oh, 8 more years. You know, he's like, 8 more years. Can it be 8 more months? No, it's 8 more years. And then you come again. No, it's 5 more years. And there had come a point in time where David would just assign himself and commit himself to the Lord. All right, it's 8 more years. I mean, I'm sure you, some of you are waiting for things right now that even if God said 8 years, you would be a little bittersweet. You go, 8 more years? But then you go, okay, all right. I'm going to count the days, you know. I'm going to do all the multiplication. If it's just 8 years, I'll take it. I'll endure it. But God doesn't do that. We don't know when it'll end. We have a relationship with Jesus that we walk by faith, not by sight. If we could have the days up on a wall and just kind of, and it's like, okay, we're almost there, then where would be the faith? We'd be counting the days and not living by faith. And some of you are trying to count the days right now when you need to be living by faith. Some of you are looking for the answer of counting the days, but what you need to do is turn your heart toward the Lord and commit your ways to Him. You know, the Bible says in Proverbs that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is death. And there always are ways that seem right to us, but we have to understand that God is the one that directs our steps. A man plans his way, the Bible says, but the Lord directs his steps. And David finally comes to that place. He's king, and the nation will now benefit from all the training of David, just like the people in your life will benefit from all the training that's taking place in your life. All the good things, all the hard things, and everything in between. David has chosen to submit to it, and that means he will theoretically, you know, in the middle, you know, when he finds he's on the run, he submits to it. And what that means in his life, he doesn't know. He's submitting to it that I will run as long as God wants me to run. Even as he was tested on it. Remember his men saw Saul in the cave, relieving himself. This is your time. Go get him. He's right there. And David, instead of taking King Saul out, he went up, remember, to his robe, and he cut a little piece of his robe off and then came out and said, I could have taken you out. You were in my hands. We were all there. But I chose not to. I trust the Lord. That was a highlight in his life. He didn't know it would end 10 years later. He just knew God and was learning to know him. And David will reign. Turn over to Psalm 119, because one of the things I believe through the Psalms we learn from David is that not only was he a man of the word, but he trusted the Lord through his word. That was a big part of his relationship, and he tells us in Psalm 119 the value of God's word in his life, and thus the value of God's word in our lives. We need to learn how to hold on to the promises of God. The promises of God are an anchor in our lives. Especially when everything is wavering around us and our own emotions are just overwhelming us and it's scary and we're not sure what's up ahead or how long it's going to last. David, he held on to the word of God, and we would do well to hold on to the promises of God. In Psalm 119, I'll just go through some verses with you of the promises of God. Notice verse 11. Your word I have hidden in my heart, Psalm 119. Your word I've hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Look at verse 16. I will delight myself in your statutes, and I will not forget your word. Verse 17. Deal bountifully with your servant that I might live and keep your word. Verse 25. My soul clings to the dust. Revive me according to your word. Verse 28. My soul melts from heaviness. Strengthen me according to your word. Verse 38, establish your word to your servant who is devoted to fearing you. Notice verse 41, let your mercies come also to me, O Lord, your salvation according to your word. Verse 50, this is my comfort in my affliction, your word has given me life. Verse 58, I entreated your favor with my whole heart. Be merciful to me according to your word. Verse 67, before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I keep your word. How many of you have that testimony? Before I was afflicted, I went astray. But it was that very affliction, that difficulty, that trial, that enormous situation, that fear, that anxiety. When that came my way, well, just like David said, I keep your word now. Turn my attention. You know how people, maybe it was you too, you get into a crisis and you find yourself all of a sudden a prayer warrior. Man, God, help me, get me out of this. And then sometimes people will say, if you get me out of this, God, I will devote my life to you forever. If you ever hear of anyone ever making that commitment to the Lord, remind them of it. It's a good commitment to make, because God will show himself faithful. God will answer a prayer. And for those of you that have dedicated yourself, I'll serve you. Man, fulfill your side of the bargain, would you? Before you were afflicted, you went astray. But it's through that affliction, through that fire, now you keep his word. Verse 68, you are good and do good. Teach me your statutes. Verse 74, those who fear you will be glad when they see me, because I have hoped in your word. Verse 89, forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Your faithfulness, verse 90, endures to all generations. You establish the earth and it abides. They continue this day according to your ordinances for all your servants. And unless, verse 92, your law had been my delight, I would have perished in my affliction. Hold on to the promises of God. Hide them in your heart. Make a commitment to keep them and follow them. Yield to them when God, by his Holy Spirit, brings them to your remembrance. Respond to them when you get that text message or that scripture pops up on your Facebook feed, or, you know, just all of a sudden, you know, at work, God brought some new believer into your work and they've got the scripture up on their computer and you happen to see it walking by their cubicle. You go, man, I've walked by this cubicle 1,000 times and I've never seen that before, because God is reminding you of his word. Hold on to his word. In 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 12, it says, so he sent and brought him in, and now he was ruddy with bright eyes and good looking. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is the one. And then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon David from that day forward. So David arose and went to Ramah. He held on to that promise till this day. And it finally arrived. Even when it seemed like it wouldn't happen, even when it felt like that would never see the day of the fulfillment, here it is. Hang on to the promises of God, gang. Hang on. Going back to 2 Samuel now, verse 6. Chapter 5, pick up in 6 with me. And the king and his men went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land, who spoke to David, saying, you shall not come in here, but the blind and the lame will repel you, thinking David cannot come in here. Nevertheless, David took the stronghold of Zion, that is, the city of David. Now David said on that day, whoever climbs up by the way of the water shaft and defeats the Jebusites, the lame and the blind who are hated by David's soul, he shall be chief and captain. Therefore, they say, the blind and the lame shall not come into the house. So David, verse 9, dwelt in the stronghold and called it the city of David. Then David built all around from the Milo and inward. So David went on and became great, and the Lord of hosts was with him. A new nation needed a new capital, and God chose Jerusalem to be that place where David would rule. Politically, Jerusalem was a Jebusite city and belonged to no individual tribe. So there wouldn't be any issues between, wait a minute, why is David choosing that tribe over this tribe? It was a completely independent city politically. Practically, Jerusalem was a safe city up high on a hill, surrounded by three sides by valleys. In Psalm 48, verse 2, it says, beautiful in elevation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion, on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. In Psalm 50, verse 2, it says, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God will shine forth. So politically, it fits. Practically, it fits. But most importantly, spiritually, it fits. Because Jerusalem was God's choice. It is God's choice. This is the city that will prophetically be important for all eternity. It's the city, if you were with us on our tour recently, that we stood there on the side of the mountain and we looked down over the Temple Mount and we said, it's because of that place that the greatest problem in the world exists, where that dome is sitting. It's a huge politically, it's huge prophetically, and it's the right choice spiritually. And you notice that God gave it to David. I'm certain that God in this decision, even though it appeared to be a very practical and very political and strategic decision, this was the appointed place of worship. This is where the temple will be built. God has set his throne there, according to Psalm 2, verse 6. And the prototype of the new Jerusalem is there, our eternal dwelling. The Jebusites thought that their city was impregnable. And as you look at it, you can see, you can understand. You can see how hard it would be to take that city, but not with God. David sent his troops and recognized that, man, for a city there, they've got to have a water source. And that's the place to go. And so he tells them to go into the shaft and find the shaft. And through this, we have a summary of taking of the city of Jerusalem. And today it is a great trial and turmoil, as there's great consternation over that small piece of real estate, according to the prophetic word of the Lord, and over Jerusalem in particular. Now, verse 11. Then Hiram, the king of Tyre, sent messengers to David, cedar trees and carpenters and masons, and they built David a house. So David knew that the Lord had established him as king over Israel, and that he had exalted his kingdom for his people Israel's sake. And David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem after he had come from Hebron, and more sons and daughters were born to David. And these are the names of those who were born to him in Jerusalem: Shammua, Shobab, Nathan, Solomon, Ibhar, Elishua, Nepheg, Japhia, Elishama, Eliada, and Eliphelet. So the king of Tyre, there's right away a rewarding of the obedience in taking the city of Jerusalem. The king of Tyre, wanting peace and wanting peace with this new nation, sent messengers, skilled workers, to help serve David, hoping, I'm sure, in exchange for a political alliance. It would have been very easy for Israel to block the trade route to Tyre because of the area that they now control. And David saw this as God's approval. David saw this as God's blessing, and that's true. But then you see the weakness of David. And I'm certain that if God was to write our story, it would be very similar. If this was, you know, can you imagine the last 10 years of your life as a book of the Bible? Think about that. There's probably some really good things in the last 10 years. Some just things of God's blessing, God's hand of approval, God's grace in your life, undeserved, unearned. And then maybe and David took more concubines. David, again, that was the political thing to do. That was the customary thing to do. And it was the very thing that God forbid. And I've mentioned it many times. I don't think we've turned back. Go back to Deuteronomy chapter 17, just so you can see it for yourself. Such blessing, such approval, such anointing, such confirmation, such victory, and such failure. The Bible forbid this. And we've mentioned it many times, but let's just read it, see it together in our own scriptures. That far before there was ever a kingdom, God had given direction for the coming kingdom. In Deuteronomy 17, pick up with me in verse 14. These are the laws for the administration of the king. When you come to the land which the Lord God is giving you, and possess it to dwell in it, and say, I will set a king over me like all the nations that are around me, you shall surely set a king over you whom the Lord your God chooses. One from among your brethren you shall set as king over you. You may not set a foreigner over you who is not your brother, but he shall not multiply horses for himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt to multiply horses. For the Lord has said to you, you shall not return that way again. Now, the idea behind multiplying horses, you got to think of it in terms of a military strategy of trusting in the strength of horses and trusting in your military might and trusting in your government might and really trusting in the hand of man. Don't do that, king. You serve God. So you don't multiply horses. That's not just having possessions. This had significance of who the king would trust to protect him and guard him. And the idea was multiplying horses beyond faith in God. So don't do that. And verse 17, neither shall he multiply wives for himself. Couldn't be clearer. David, how many wives are you supposed to have? Well, David's not here, but what would we say to him? One, don't you multiply wives, nor shall he multiply, number three, silver and gold for himself. Don't use the position, don't use the leadership to multiply gold and silver for yourself. But the key that we see him here is he took more concubines, a very bad decision. The right way would have been to obey the Lord. Now, verse 17. When the Philistines heard that they had anointed king over Israel, David king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David. And David heard of it and went down to the stronghold. The Philistines also went and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And David, verse 19, inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go up against the Philistines? Will you deliver them into my hand? And the Lord said to David, go up, for I will doubtless deliver the Philistines into your hand. So David went to Baal Perazim, and David defeated them there. And he said, the Lord has broken through my enemies before me like a breakthrough of water. Therefore, he called the name of that place Baal Perazim. And they all left their images there, and David and his men carried them away. Then the Philistines went up, verse 22, once again, and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And when David inquired of the Lord, he said, you shall not go up. Circle around behind them and come up upon them in front of the mulberry trees. So it shall be, when you hear the sound of the marching in the tops of the mulberry trees, then you shall advance quickly, for then the Lord will go out before you to strike the camp of the Philistines. And David did so as the Lord commanded him, and he drove back the Philistines from Geba as far as Gezer. So while the king of Tyre wanted peace, the Philistines wanted war, and they attacked David twice, very rapidly. David's response both times, he sought the Lord. Very wise response when you're attacked. Seek the Lord. The results both times, victory. And we have to pause at verse 22 and ask, why pray? You know, why pray? Why do we pause and seek the Lord when it seems so obvious? This just happened. God told me already, when the Philistines come, attack them. And this again is that place where we go from one victory where we're going to see with the nation, or what we saw actually earlier in the life of Joshua, is where he had great victory at Jericho and great defeat at Ai, because in Jericho he sought the Lord, in Ai he took it upon himself. So it could be that David's just learning his lesson here. It could be that David is just understanding the reality of what it is to seek the Lord every time. But that is the mistake we often make. We kind of size up the situation. We look back to what we've done before, and we go, well, why pray? I already know how to handle this one. I've already been here. I've already taken care of this. But that's not wise. God doesn't always do things the same way. There's variety with God. He doesn't always handle things the same way. He's not always going to do it. He's not predictable, our God, nor is he controllable. We need to ask constantly. Jesus told us that we need to continue to ask, and we need to continue to knock, and we need to continue to seek. God may want to do something different. He may want to do it a different way. God is not limited and will not be limited to our patterns and our demands. God reserves the privilege of being free and sovereign and in control. He works as he wants to work. And we should not find ourselves guilty of trying to formulate the pattern by which God works and demanding that God work this way and then being disappointed and upset with God when he doesn't work our way. You know, we can come to God for wisdom and we say, God, what do you want to do? Or what happens often is we formulate the plan and we say, well, God, bless this plan. Now, that plan may or may not be from the Lord, but oftentimes it's not. It's interesting how we always want to put things to formulas. We always want to package things up. We want to have seminars on how to do things, conferences of how God works, programs and techniques. You know, in the realm of which I serve in the pastoral ministry, there's always some new thing that's put together and packaged of how to grow your church. You can grow your church this way, and you can grow your church that way, and you can, well, what they always fail to say on the first page is that the church belongs to the Lord, and He'll give the increase as He desires. You just teach the word and love the people and let God do what He wants to do with the church. Just because you followed a pattern and the church has grown doesn't mean it's from the Lord. God will draw people together because He loves people. But we don't want to fall for that. Don't waste your money buying all the packages. Prayer is free. Now, we need to recognize that God can and will work in many different ways, and He does. The second battle shows us how God does work in different ways. He tells him in the second battle, the first one, just go on after him. But the second one, when David, verse 23, inquires of the Lord, he says, "You shall not go up." What should they do instead? Circle around and come up in front of those trees, those mulberry trees. And then it will be when you hear the sound of the marching in the tops of the mulberry trees as it starts to move, that's when you should advance quickly, because then the Lord will go out before you. So they could have gone out themselves, but the Lord would not have gone before them. This is the way. You follow God's way. God wants His will done His way. And when you do God's will His way, He goes before you. That's how you want your battles being fought. God going before us. As we're serving Jesus and leading His church, let's seek to discover God's will. What does He want to do? Seek to find out where and when the Spirit is moving and move with the Spirit, not formulating our own plans. Not to lay out a program and then say, "Lord, bless this," but rather, "God, what do You want to be doing? We need to be where You're already working, serving and reaching this city." So our prayers can be really wasted because it's just our program and just wanting God to do our thing. And ultimately, we really don't want God to do our own thing. We want to do God. We want to do God's thing, and we want to follow Him. So be careful. You know, you look at this, and God had a whole new thing for the Philistines. Because, you know, the Philistines aren't seeking the Lord. You know, the enemy gets far too much credit because the enemy is not God. And he's got predictable patterns. And, you know, God knows in advance what's going on in our lives. When we seek God for wisdom, He knows how to direct us. The devil doesn't ask God for wisdom. He can't. The Philistines didn't ask. They didn't inquire. They're going to do the same thing over and over again. They're going to go forward on the children of Israel with military strategy, and they're going to go back, "Well, they defeated us this way, so we're going to do this." But God already knows that. Don't go at them. Go around this way and wait. And then as soon as you see the trees start to move, then go. And you're like, "Okay, Lord, I want You on my side." It's so much easier to have God be on God's side because He goes before us, discovering the will of God, the ways of God, and moving with God rather than trying to get God to move with us is so much more peaceful. And so God gave him a completely different battle plan. And here in the beginning, there's great successes. Even though with David, there's also failure, God is going to bless His nation through David. So God, we just know that you have new plans that You want to reveal to us. You have new, fresh revelation that You want, not new doctrine, not new pages of the Bible, but new answers for old questions in our lives. We come to these battle arrays and strategies and think that we've always done it this way, but You have a new way and You have a new direction and You have a freshness that's awaiting us. You have forgive us for formulating our own plans or trying to limit You to a plan or to a model. And Lord, keep us fresh and open to a new work of Your Spirit, that we wouldn't become old wineskins, where You're wanting to do something new in us, and as You're wanting to do something new, we're so rigid and inflexible that we burst open, and we're lost, and the new wine is lost, and everything is lost, Lord. But rather, soften us by the work of Your Holy Spirit. Replenish us. And take the years of experience and the years that we've walked with You, Lord, and soften us afresh and anew with Your Spirit, Lord, the anointing oil of Your Spirit, that we might be able to take in the fresh new work You want to do in these days. It could be something as easy as a little new technology or a new way of doing things. We have the same steady, solid word. The gospel never changes. And yet, Lord, our methods might change, or we might do it something differently. And you're just testing and challenging us of whether we'll wait for the mulberry trees, Lord. We won't go forward, but we'll circle around and we'll do something new. And we just wait to see what you want to do. But we want to inquire of you first. And again, I pray for new and freshness, new steps and new freshness, whether it's Pastor Joel going so new and fresh up in North Aurora, or now it's Adrian and Alex heading off all the way to the other side on the West Coast, Lord, over in Portland. Continue to pour out your Holy Spirit in these last days. Continue to do a work that only you can do. There's millions upon millions of people, billions of people that haven't bowed the knee, that are desperate, and they're going to live out this verse. We're going to meet so many of them. Before I was afflicted, I went astray. And we'll just be there, Lord, to help them in their affliction, to help them in their challenge, in their trial, and lead them in the way everlasting. And if you're here today, you've never given your life to Jesus, you never asked him to save you, You've never asked him, like, you're in that place right now. Before I was afflicted, I went astray. Your old life was living apart from God. And today, God is calling you to himself. He's saying, okay, I've got your attention. And I sent my son, Jesus Christ, because I love you. To forgive you of your sins, to rescue you from yourself, from the brokenness of your life. If that's you today, I want to invite you to receive the Lord Jesus Christ. Accept him into your life. Bow the knee now. You know, the Bible says that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. The only problem with that is that there'll be a group of people, when they bow the knee and confess, it'll be too late. It'll be too late for them. They'll be only acknowledging a truth they rejected their entire lives. That's why, while you're alive and you can hear my voice, this is the time to confess Jesus Christ. This is the time to literally or symbolically bow the knee in submission to the God who gave his son Jesus to die for you. Messiah, fulfilling prophecy. He lived, he died, and he rose again. It was predicted. From the very beginning, in Adam and Eve, it was predicted that God would rescue. There were pictures and signs of the coming Messiah. And Jesus, he came and fulfilled many prophecies. And today he's calling you into a relationship with himself. And so if that's you, I just want you to pray. I want you to ask God to forgive you of your sins. Admit that you've sinned against him. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Confess your sins to him and turn away from them, committing yourself to follow him today. I mean, it's a real decision. It might be emotional for you. It might not be emotional. It might stir up feelings in you. It might not. You don't need to worry about that part. You follow through with your commitments. Maybe you're the one that when you are in affliction, you cried out and you said, God, if you get me out of this, I'll serve you the rest of my life. And today is the day that you fulfill that commitment. You went astray again. And if it's you committed yourself, you said, man, I'll follow you, God. Well, God is asking you. He's asking you to follow him. Fulfill your commitment. He gave his son for you. Now commit yourself to him. And so, Lord, I just know that those that would cry out to you today, those that would pray and turn their lives towards you today, turning away from sin, that truly would repent, that you hear that prayer, that you hear that cry, that you hear that desperation. And now, because of their affliction, they're turning to your word. They're believing you. And it's changing their lives. And we just want in our own hearts tonight to be affirmed in our faith, Lord. We want, like the psalmist did, like David did, your word, your word, your word, your precepts, your ordinances, that we truly would yield to them as we seek wisdom from above. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's stand together, church, as we head out. If you responded to the gospel today, whether you're here or out on the radio or on TV, listening to this on an MP3, it needs to be followed through. You can't just, you know, say a prayer and then go live your own regular old life like you always have. Like, you made a commitment. And so if you're here in the room, we have packets up here, and pastors will, and men and women on the prayer team will be here to talk to you about it, answer some questions, and put you on the right track. Because, you know, a lot of times people are like, what am I supposed to do next? Well, we'll help you with that. And we'll answer your questions and explain to you more fully what it means for God to send his own son to die for you. But if you're out on the internet or on the radio, you can go to our website at calvaryaurora.org and connect with us that way. And we'd love to connect with you. We have pastors and leaders that follow up on those phone calls and emails. And so contact us. We'd love to serve.